Ladies and gentlemen, the next session is Cutting Through Politics, Michigan's Bipartisan Leadership. Please welcome U.S. Representative Debbie Dingell, U.S. Representative Brenda Lawrence, U.S. Representative Dave Trott, U.S. Representative Fred Upton, and to moderate the discussion, the senior producer and host of Michigan Matters, Carol King.
Here we go. We look
right
into the chat.
Slip right into it.
Want a lot of water?
The escapees.
Really? Wow. Good afternoon, everybody. So this is the panel that talks about political civility in Congress. Before we get started, I know somewhere out there is the Dean of Congress, John Dingell. Where are you?
In the back.
There you go. Congressman John Dingell. So the Dean served for 59 years. He's turning 91 in July, so happy birthday. He's also the Twitter king. Donald Trump may try to take that title, but we know the congressman is part of that. So this panel was intended to talk about bipartisan compromise, talking about some of the debate and civility in Congress. We know since it's been 133 days, and maybe to some of you more like 133 years, since Trump's style of campaigning and governance heightened the rhetoric and partisan divide, but it makes working collaboratively probably a little more tenuous. So I'm just going to ask all of you, since there's four of you, our time is tight, if you could just give us kind of capsule summary of what your time has been like then, and Congressman Dingell, why don't we start with you?
Well, it's been interesting. I have been very committed to we are Americans, and where we can work together, we need to work together. And where there are things that endanger the Constitution or our national security or the people, the working men and women that I represent, I'm going to fight it tooth and nail. I think our delegation is actually trying to work together on all things Michigan. We may disagree, maybe even strongly, on things like health care. But when it comes to, I've got bills going with both Fred and David on a number of subjects, from Line 5 in the Mackinac Bridge. David and I have a letter that's circulating today on nuclear waste in the Great Lakes. Fred and I have a multitude of things, manufacturing, autos we're working on. We're trying to work together.
I have found this term to be one that has been inconsistent. I'm craving for leadership. There is nothing wrong with you being a Democrat or Republican, but you have an agenda. You have a platform, you have priorities. I'm struggling to find those things. Someone asked me about stability in Congress and politicians. I think that you should never be called anything but what your mother named you. But when it comes to speaking truth to power, that's never a negotiation. And there has been some rhetoric that kind of says it's a fake news or whatever. There's only two things. There's the truth and there's a lie. We need to really understand that policy impacts every American in this country, and we need to make laws that will lift all ships. And I will continue to, I'm working with the president to do a transportation plan. I serve on transportation. I'm with him 100%. However, immigration ban, totally against them. And so when it comes to civility, it's not giving up the fight and speaking truth to power.
So I'm in my second term, just like Brenda and Debbie, and I would often say during my first term that I was surprised at how capable and well-intended the members of Congress were, and my district staff would give me a hard time because they would say, you know, Dave, when you say that, you need to remember that most Americans don't think much of Congress, and you're saying compliments of the institution. But that being said, I have found it to be dysfunctional, and our current environment certainly has exacerbated that problem. We are about as partisan as we could be. The Democrats are committed to block everything that Trump wants to do, in part because they view that the Republicans did that for 6 years to President Obama. And then also the flip side is President Trump hasn't figured out Washington enough to the point where he has gained any political capital to use in terms of influencing Congress. So it's a partisan deadlock, and with the special counsel doing an investigation for a year, for the foreseeable future, you would think that we're going to have problems getting things done.
So for me, I had the privilege of working for a guy by the name of Ronald Reagan for a number of years. And you know, we had a Democratic Congress and Republican administration. And gosh, he won 49 states when he ran for re-election because he learned who the characters were and how he could work with them. And we had a great agenda over those years that I served him. I've followed that same pattern for me in the Congress. So there has not been a bill that I've worked on that I haven't tried to be bipartisan. I chaired the Energy and Commerce Committee. I followed in the heels of a great leader, John Dingell, who tapped me to do a good number of things when he was chairman, Democrat, me a lowly Republican, as the lowest guy on the ladder. And we had a very good agenda that President Obama signed a good number of our bills, hundreds of them. And as I look at this start now, just to conclude, it is, I hate the partisanship. And you'll never see me throwing these hand grenades or blowing people up. I have the greatest respect for all of my colleagues. And I enjoy, truly, working with most of all of my colleagues on issues. Certainly these two, absolutely these two. And then Michigan, I can name one or two, but they're not here. They're not from Michigan. But it's, you know, you got to get through that. We get tougher skin, but that's what the country wants. And, you know, I don't know if you'll see that we're all working together to get a new lock here in Michigan. Yeah. Man, it should have been done decades ago. It impacts the whole economy if we don't get this thing done. The environment, I'm one for not pulling out of the Paris Accords. And I don't know what the president's going to say a little bit later, but, you know, we got to work together. We do have to work together. And Michigan, we've proven that our delegation can.
Mm-hmm. President Trump announced his budget proposal, and in it was conversation about funding for the Great Lakes, which is on the chopping block. I know this, as we sit here in Mackinac Island, in the midst of the Great Lakes, the question is, how, with what is being proposed, affect the state, and how are you planning to step up and make sure the Great Lakes receive the funding necessary, either individually or collectively? And Congressman Trott, why don't you start that?
Mm-hmm. Well, our delegation is united in bipartisan basis to push back on the president's proposal to zero out the Great Lakes Restoration Initiative from $300 million to zero. We won't support the budget if that's what comes out. Keep in mind, the president's budget is just a starting point. We're going to do our own budget in the House. And I'm confident whatever we come up with, if it ends up on the president's desk, he'll sign it. So we're not paying a whole lot of attention to the president's budget. We're going to come up with our own, and it will have money in it for the Great Lakes Race Russian Initiative.
I was so proud to be part of the delegation where we all came together collectively. I mean, there was no one that was pondering, and you know, sometimes there's discussion, well, you know, I don't want it to be too leaning toward the Democrats. This is something we're all together on. And we are committed that we will not support a budget that does not include protection of our Great Lakes.
Either one of you want to weigh in?
I would just expand it because he's also, there were rumors that they're trying to close Region 5 of the EPA. In Chicago, there's talk of trying to close the Ann Arbor lab. There are a number of environmental issues that we all feel very strongly about, and you all have heard quietly. There was a very bipartisan letter from throughout the Great Lakes region about Region 5, and the Republicans, who are closer to Steve Pruitt than perhaps some of us are, have gotten assurances that they're not going to close Region 5, right?
So. We hope
maybe.
So. We hope so.
There's lots of, you don't know what they say this hour is going to be the next hour. But anyway, we are working really closely together.
And I'll just add one new thought, and that is, for a long time, our delegation, you know, when I came to Congress, we had some real giants on the Appropriations Committee, on both sides of the aisle. We had Bob Carr. We had Carl Purcell. I mean, the list is, we had Joe Nolenberg. We had some really good men and women on both sides of the aisle. Then for a good number of years, we didn't have anybody. So that's the one real weakness that our delegation has. We had nobody in the Senate. Maybe going back to, you know, the 50s, I don't know when. I tried to Google it, and the Google wasn't around back then, so they don't have the answer. But in the House, we didn't have any, but now we do. We got John Molinar, rep from Midland. So if he had stayed in the state Senate, he would have been chairman of the state Senate Appropriations Committee. And So we worked to get him on there. So he now, in the last 5 months, has been on that committee. So he is going to be, as I said, he's got to have our back on all these different issues, whether it be the Great Lakes, whether it be the NIH, whether it be all those different things. He's now a voice, because so many times these appropriation bills are not going to get to the House floor. So they're going to be done in committee. So you can't, we can't have an amendment in committee, but he can. So he's got to look out for us, and he will.
As part of the conversation about the Great Lakes up here in Mackinac, particularly with the Mackinac Straits, is the conversation about Pipeline 5, which carries 23 million gallons of oil and natural gas each day across the Straits back and forth. A lot of people in the audience I know are involved in this conversation and have weighed in. Individually, as Congress people, representatives, where do you stand on some people who say it should be shut now? Mm-hmm. And what are you doing collectively to make sure it's safer? And
Let me just start off. So we had a spill, not in my district, but close by, Calhoun County, a few years ago. Enbridge Pipeline, you might remember, was literally a billion-dollar cleanup. And I worked with, I was on the committee with John Dingell back then. It was in Mark Schauer's congressional district. And we learned a number of things from that terrible day a few summers ago. Since then, we've passed two pipeline safety bills. President Obama signed them both. They were overwhelmingly bipartisan. There might have been one person that voted against it. We upgraded the standards. We upgraded the fines. And in fact, that particular pipeline has been completely replaced at $4.1 million a mile, going from Detroit all the way down to Niles, Michigan, which is in my district. We know about Line 5. And in the second pipeline safety bill, the first one is called Upton Dingell. And the second one that the president signed this last year, President Obama, we again upgraded the standards. And I inserted a provision in pipelines like Line 5 that go under a long, sizable length of water, that they now have to be inspected every year. We're not going to just rely on someone saying, oh, it's going to be okay. So on this particular pipeline, there's automatic shutoff valves on both sides of the UP and the lower peninsula. It's going to be inspected, I think, within the next month or two in the terms of the annual inspection. They're going to be fully transparent, as they should be, and we're going to let everyone get a good chance to look at it. I know the governor's on top of this. He's had the Enbridge folks in a number of times. I have as well. We want to make sure that there is no possibility of a break.
So is that a yes or no about Pipeline 5? You talked about putting extra precautions in place.
Yeah, we have an extra precaution there now.
Would like to keep it going then?
Yeah, no, it's, well, so what do you do then? Yeah, it takes decades to replace a pipeline if you're going to reroute it in terms of the permitting process. That particular pipeline takes oil down to the Marathon refinery where they just expanded that by $3 billion. So we want to make sure that it's safe. We're going to take every precaution to make sure that it's safe. We've got two committees of jurisdiction, transportation as well as energy and commerce, and if we do need to do more, we will do it.
I sit on transportation. I want to say this is why the conversation about EPA restrictions, guidelines. So you can't say that you protect the environment and you care about the environment, then you're weakening all of those provisions that we have put in place to ensure that we don't have spills. One of the reasons why I didn't support the pipeline is because they would not require those provisions that we're talking about in the pipeline. When there's spills, you have tremendous amount of cost damage to our environment. And so it is imperative that we start talking about how to reroute it. And if these guidelines, it has to be time sensitive, if these commitments to enhancing the protection of this is not adhered to, it should be shut off.
So it should be shut off. At some point, this 64-year-old pipeline is going to leak. Mm-hmm. It's going to happen. And when Debbie and I introduced our bill, Enbridge came rushing in to meet with me, and they said, you really don't need to worry about this. The pipeline is like new. Turns out there's 18 places in the pipeline that the outer coating has deteriorated away. And they said, and plus we have, just like we had in Calhoun County, we have emergency shutoff valves that will shut down the pipeline immediately if there's a leak. Well, they had that in Calhoun County in Line 6, I believe it was, mm-hmm. and they didn't work. Yep. And the only reason why they shut that pipeline down was some random bystander called them up and said, you got a leak here, and they finally went and shut it off. So the assurances I've received are meaningless. The study that's being done by the state, I applaud the state and the governor for their efforts, but the study's being paid for by Enbridge, and they get to see the report 5 days before it's released to the public. I don't understand that. So we want our bill to move forward so we can have some federal oversight, and ultimately I'd like to see it shut down and come up with a different alternative. By the way, most of the oil doesn't end up in the U.S.
That's right. Pastor.
I think it's been said, but I will say it's their own report that shows where the weaknesses are in the line. And as David said, they say, oh, we're on top of it. It leaked for 18 hours before anybody realized it was leaking. So we all care deeply.
The other thing that you're going to, some of you will be doing tomorrow, the delegation is going to visit the Sioux Lacs tomorrow. Mm-hmm. And I know, Congresswoman, you were saying this is the first time you will have been there. I don't know if others of you have been to the Sioux Lacs before, but
I think David and I, it's our first visit.
You're newbies to it, okay. Mm-hmm. So what do you hope to accomplish by visiting this, and what's the purpose?
There has been so much data given to us about the importance of the Sioux Lacs when it comes to our economy, when it comes to trade. And for whatever reason, like so many of our infrastructure challenges around the country, we keep kicking it down the road. We would have if this lock, we're down to one, fails, it would have a tremendous immediate impact on our economy, on trade, and being able to transmit commerce from Canada and other countries to the United States. It is something that we are going to be the choir in Congress. We're going to have to use our voices and our collaborations to enhance this. I sit on transportation, and so I have Mitchell and I sit on transportation, and we're both committed to making sure that we continue to push for funding to do this. I'm a person, I like to smell, touch it, and kick it, and I can get it better, so I'm looking forward to the visit.
Anyone else on the Sioux?
Bipartisan legislation is going to be introduced next week. Debbie Stabenow is going to do it in the Senate. Jack Bergman in the House. We're all going to be co-sponsors. We're going to use every contact we have throughout the Midwest, the Great Lakes Coalition and others. This way, if something happened, there have been estimates that you could see the unemployment rate in the U.S. double because of the impact on the autos, on appliances, on all the manufacturing jobs. I think Tim Walberg, who's in the audience, talked about thousands of jobs. He's got the one port in Michigan that's on Lake Erie. These are 1,000-foot freighters. There's not a lot of, there's like a foot and a half on either side. Every ship that goes through because of the bow thrusters dislodges stone along the way. So there's no alternative. Shipping and these boats, it's the most economical way. It's the only way we could possibly get that to market. And this should have been replaced decades ago. Congress actually authorized it.
In the 80s.
But we didn't have the funds. It's a two-step process. You authorize and appropriate. The authorizers worked, the appropriators didn't. We got to come up with the money to get it done.
So it wasn't that long ago when Congress and Senate, anybody from Michigan and Washington was not getting much attention. We know the global economy fell apart 2009. People were going to Washington trying to get help, and it was a very tough time for Michigan Congress people, senators, and others here. I think the country since then has realized how important the auto industry in particular is, getting more attention here. So what is the environment like now? And Congressman Dingell, let me start with you. What's the environment like now as a congressperson representing Michigan when you're doing things, talking about automotive, manufacturing, things that did not get their just desserts before that time?
Well, I actually would, the auto industry is cyclical. It's cyclical economically, and it's cyclical in Congress. So I think that if you were to talk to anybody that was around the Congress in the 70s, thankfully I was young and not, but on
safety. You're still young.
Thank you. Fred and I are the same age. We're seasoned, but young. But that, we were doing emission standards, clean air standards. That was a very active time. I think a lot of people didn't realize what was happening to the industry in 2007 and 2008. And I would actually say to you, I was one of the people that said that Donald Trump that Michigan could go Republican and that he could win. And I think a lot of people don't understand that people haven't gotten over 2008 and 2009 in this state. They haven't forgotten that fear and anxiety that their job could disappear at any second. They don't feel like they're playing on a level playing field. I think the Congress, it was one of the most, the auto industry wasn't loved. People voted that this delegation pulled together. I was outside watching and knew that they had to do it to save the economy. President Bush didn't want to do what he did, but one in eight jobs was connected to it. But for years, people didn't approve of what happened, and people have forgotten the auto industry. I say this to Fred all the time, that there are probably five of us in the House that even know auto issues. And I've been the skunk at the picnic for the last couple of weeks back in Washington again, because I've said, oh, yep, high five, isn't it great about Russia? And Russia does matter. National security matters. But anybody who read the Wall Street Journal and saw that Ford Motor Company was looking at cutting headcount by 10%, and then the next day, oh, thankfully, it's only 1,400 jobs. You see the General Motors announcement now. The OEMs are showing a softening. Our job is to work together, and we do, and are committed to working together to protect manufacturing, to ensure that there is an economic climate, that we're supporting policies that let us play currency manipulation on a level playing field, tax policies, and we do need to work together and remind people that it's about jobs and the economy. And it's here, like it or not, it's going to be back in the Congress, and we're talking about it again.
Congressman Upton?
You know, a couple things. We had some of the major Michigan manufacturers come out to Washington last week. I spent a little time with them. We all did, bipartisan basis again. And tax code is something that they all care about. We want, you know, we can get into the deficit and the debt and that type of thing. We don't get out of that mess unless we finally get to at least a 3% growth rate. And in the short term, we're not going to get there. We're not even half of that right now. So as we look at, you know, what our manufacturing folks are talking about, and I saw some billboards coming up here as well, we gotta invest in the future. That's why I flew up with Mark Schlessel yesterday coming up, and he was really excited about what we did on the NIH funding, National Institutes of Health, because that's gonna find the cure for these diseases. But if you don't do the research now to find the cure, you don't get those savings down the road. Our businesses, whether they be auto or furniture or pharmaceuticals or whatever, they want to get to 3%, and they know that we have to invest in that. And that's why a tax bill, which I happen to believe, bipartisan one, really helps us move in that direction with the proper force that we need to get there. And that's really what they're looking for the Congress to do now. Yes, we need infrastructure spending. And I heard the long debate on roads and bridges and the lock. And that's going to be bipartisan. But our next big issue that we're going to deal with now in the Congress is tax reform. And I'm convinced that it can be and will be bipartisan.
I think there's an excitement in Washington about what's happening in Michigan and Detroit and the automotive sector. And you know, it was great the president came into Willow Run and visited there. And there's no question that, you know, Southeast Michigan's going to have a major role in the development of autonomous vehicles. And even beyond that, you know, the application of artificial intelligence will far exceed its utility beyond, you know, the automotive sector. And it's exciting that Michigan's part of it. So.
What steps can we take in Congress to make sure Michigan is at the cutting edge, remains there, of the self-driving vehicle market? Anything specific you want to mention?
One of the things I wanted to jump in and talk about when we talk about Detroit and the auto industry, skilled trade workforce. Ladies and gentlemen, we were the leaders in a labor workforce unionized, where you could walk out of high school, go into a factory, instantly become middle class because you had a union job, you could buy your kid, send your kid to college, buy a house and all that. Those days are gone. And we are right now, the average age of skilled trade worker in America is 53. We are in danger of all this innovation we're talking about, on autonomous vehicle and that we won't be able to sustain our innovation, because a skilled workforce is extremely critical. The labor jobs are now being innovated in robots and technology, but we have a growing need for skilled trades, the bridge we want to build to Canada, welders. Ladies and gentlemen, if we don't, in education and in our community colleges, start taking and embracing this skilled trade, you're not a failure if you don't go to college. Some of the skilled trade jobs, those who work on those electrical lines, are six-figure jobs. A tool and die worker in a factory, $90,000 without student debt. And we are going to have to adapt what Canada does. When a child reaches the 12th grade, you go to a technical institution or you go to college. In either one, you're successful contributing citizens of the country. We are going to have to be leaders, and I have to give the governor kudos. He has started a welding program in prison where people who are nonviolent, who are in reaching parole, can enter into a welding program, and they're being offered jobs before they leave prison. Think about the recidivism rate. We cannot continue to imprison people at the rate we're doing it. We cannot continue to say you serve your time, send you home, and don't give you a job. And we have unemployment that's unacceptable in the city of Detroit, and we have an opportunity here. And whenever we talk about what the auto industry does, we need to be, just like we put the country on wheels, we need to be turning out skilled trade workers here in Michigan like no other state.
Else. So President Trump won on his conversation about undoing Obamacare. There's been a lot of conversation about the Affordable Care Act, which Congressman Dingell in the audience was influential and very involved with. Congressman Trott, I don't want to say you changed your vote, but you changed support for a bill that helped it get through the House, and explain what was behind
Upton.
Upton. Explain a little bit
Fred.
About
Fred. Just use
Fred.
First name. That's all right.
I don't want you to blame Trott, David, unfairly.
Yes.
I was thinking I was going to him on something else. Anyway, so explain a little bit about why you switched your vote in the presidential, you had a conversation with Donald Trump about
that. The whole Obamacare, I mean, Debbie and I sat through a 27-hour hearing. People said, did you read the bill?
Markup.
No, we had the bill read to us.
It's a markup.
It's right.
We had no
There are a couple issues that I really care about strongly. One is to protect the 31 states like Michigan that expanded Medicaid. We have about 650,000 individuals that take advantage of that.
679,000.
Well, I said about 650, so it's... and we work very closely with Rick Snyder and John Kasich and Chris Christie and, you know, Mike Pence, their state expanded Medicaid as well. And there was actually an effort on the Republican side that I helped thwart, I guess you could say, that was going to end the Medicaid expansion the end of this calendar year. And we said, that's not going to happen. We need a proper transition period. And what we did was we extended it for a couple of years. We protected the universe of people that were included there. But the other issue that I really cared about was pre-existing illnesses. And after the bill left our committee, there was a provision that was added that would allow states, if they chose, to seek a waiver to waive essential health benefits, which included pre-existing illnesses. And I said, I can't accept that when that provision was added. And I let our leadership know, and a couple days later, I was told the president was gonna call, and I had frankly not met the president until March of this year. And I said, you know, Mr. President, you said over the weekend, a few days before, that you wanted to make sure that pre-existing illnesses were covered just as much in Obamacare as the American Health Care Act, the one that we marked up. And I said, they're not. You're allowing the states to waive it. And I can't accept it. And we had a long conversation, and it ended. And he had a conversation with a number of my colleagues later on. They said the same thing. And so we crafted an amendment that actually provides $8 billion added to the $130 billion. Specifically for high-risk pools for states that might seek and receive a waiver to cover those folks with pre-existing illnesses. And that amendment was accepted, so the bill changed. I was going to vote and announce that I was going to vote against the bill as without that amendment. And, you know, the question, we didn't have a CBO score then, we do now. And the question was asked by a lot of folks, is that $8 billion enough? Mm. I don't know. I think that it is. I'm told that it is. But I also said, if it's not, we're going to be first in line to get more money to make sure that it's covered. Now, where are we now? So the Senate, of course, as we know, they're starting from scratch. Don't know what they're going to do. My sense is that they, looking at what happened in the House, they will make sure, ensure that pre-existing illnesses are covered. Maybe strengthen them from what we did. I hope that they do. I know what I'll do if they weaken it. I know that I've offered a number of suggestions to a number of the senators that are part of that group that is writing the bill, particularly on those on Medicaid expansion. We'll see what they do. And at the end, I hope that they can, in fact, improve the bill that we did, and we'll see what happens.
So, Congressman Dingell, do you prefer Congressman Dingell or Congresswoman Dingell?
I am Debbie, and Fred is Fred. We are more of
those
two.
All right.
I'm a Debbie.
This is because you and I call you Debbie, so we're in a formal setting here, so I'm trying to be formal here with it.
Okay. I'm still Debbie, formal.
Okay, so formal Debbie. How do you feel... How do you feel about what Fred just said?
You know, Fred and I have had many long talks, and he is a good friend, and he is probably one of John Dingell's best friends. But having said that, we are an example of where two people can deeply disagree. And he knows I'm very upset about the Affordable Care Act. First of all, the fact that we're even having to have this discussion about existing conditions because they changed the essential services provision of the bill and are now allowing states to opt out of mental health coverage, prenatal care coverage, and other essential services. We shouldn't even be having this discussion. We shouldn't be, that's the first. And I know he cares about people with pre-existing condition, but we have a very different approach on this. It's the people that are most vulnerable. It is the sickest. It is people that have disabilities. It is the seniors that are the most worried. And first of all, the CBO scores come in, and 23 million people have their health insurance ripped away. That deeply worries me. And when we talk about Medicaid, and again, I know that he cares, but you know, this bill is so detailed. And I want you to know, I have read every page of this bill. I was going to read that bill. I didn't understand half of what I was reading because I had to find 16 other bills to go back to. But when people do read it, but you talk about the Medicaid provision, and I want to give kudos to Governor Rick Snyder, who passed Healthy Michigan. The day I remember is when that bill was signed, and John Dingell and Rick Snyder stood on the stage together. They both had a glint in their eye that both knew they were doing something right, and the far right and the far left were both attacking him by that afternoon. So you know something was right. But, you know, having said that, he stayed... But you remember that day. But he stayed... True. He is stayed true to fighting for those people that have health care coverage. They're only covered through December 31st, 2019. And then Healthy Michigan has made a difference in many people's lives. We have to make sure that we take care of people. If you live in this country, I believe you've got a right to affordable, quality health care. Now bill is upside down. Everybody's worried about it. Even you guys will admit that the House bill is not a great bill, and you hope that the Senate will improve
it.
Look, the Affordable Care Act isn't perfect. We need to work together to improve it. But let's work together to improve it. Not pass a bill that's going to make it so expensive you've got a pre-existing condition, you're not going to be able to afford it, even with high-risk pools. Everybody in this room has an option to buy a BMW, but anyway, none of us would because that's a foreign car. But how many of us can afford to buy it? I never use a domestic car, though, when I use that example, because we can all afford a Cadillac or Lincoln. But anyway, I'm pretty intense on this subject.
Tell us what you really think.
I want to say that I agree with everything Debbie has said. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the part of me being in Congress, and Trott and I have talked about this. So we have an existing health care plan. there are some people and that has identified clearly there are some problems with it. Why in the name of goodness did we not, as members of Congress, sit down and fix what was wrong with it? But based on a political promise, campaign promise, we are now put in this position, and it's like little ducks going down the road saying, okay, now we have to repeal and replace. Well, there are some things wrong with the Affordable Health Care Act. I refuse to call it Obamacare because people did that to demonize it. It was the attempt to make sure that in America, our compassion and our beliefs is that everyone, like Debbie said, has access to health care. Now, it was the portion of it for us, the essential benefits that cover things like mental health, drug treatments, pregnancy, believe it or not. But any of you in this room that have hypertension, have had heart disease, that has diabetes, you are pre-existing condition. And you are on the chopping block when it comes to insurance for the Affordable Health Care Act. Now, we get that our children, thank goodness, everyone seems to agree that our children need that safety net for us to cover them until they can become independent and working and can pay for their own insurance. This is one of those moments in that I am living my dream. I'm so proud to have the vote of trust from the American citizens to send me to Washington. Why is it we cannot sit down and say, stop? This does not make sense. We do not need to go to the Rose Garden and celebrate with beer cans for something that's dealing with something so serious like health care. This is a time for us to roll up our sleeves. You know, we keep referring to the John Dingell days and days when you were there. David and I would love to sit there and roll up our sleeves and fight about issues. And at the end of the day, take care of the people. What are we celebrating, a political victory? When we're talking about health care of American citizens, do the work that the people sent us. That's why they're so frustrated.
So the process was frustrating to me. To Brenda's point, it was a very partisan process. The Affordable Care Act and its enactment was also very partisan. It's an example when people should sit in a room and work on a solution, and you have some give and take, and you come up with a better solution, one that can stand the test of time. Because if there's a different president in 2020, then whatever we do will be undone. And not only is that not fair to consumers and the uncertainty it creates, but it's a waste of a lot of energy. That being said, you know, the Affordable Care Act had more than just a few problems. I mean, I would talk to constituents and they would tell me their premiums have doubled, their deductible is unaffordable, and they have an insurance card, but they can't use it. And a third of the counties in the country have only one provider. The cost of health care went up. One fact that I followed closely is the cost of administering the insurance per individual before the Affordable Care Act was $400 a person annually, went up to $1,800 to administer insurance for one person. That was the cost of administering the insurance, not the cost of the health care. So it wasn't working. Now, what we've done, and I hope the Senate comes back with a better solution, because I didn't think we passed a great bill, but I hope they come back with something. I'm not sure what we sent them is going to get 50 votes. I'm not sure what they'll send us. We'll get 218 votes, so we could be stymied every which way. That being said, if we do have some momentum here, this is the first of many steps. The next step in the process is Secretary Price and regulatory reform and trying to figure out a way to lower the cost of health care. If we don't lower the cost of health care, none of these plans are going to work, whether it's the Affordable Care Act or American Health Care Act. Neither one of them are going to work unless we drive down the costs. And so we have a long ways to go. We'll see what the Senate does, and I hope they can make some improvements, particularly as it relates to essential health benefits, and then we'll get back to work in the House and hopefully give Americans what they want, which is health care they can afford.
Another issue that's received a lot of attention here in the state has to do with immigration. We know under Donald Trump and talk of immigration reform, lots of different ideas and plans and rhetoric coming out of Washington. As it translates here, how do you see this conversation about immigration reform going as far as what will ultimately happen here with this?
It's been interesting to watch the new administration tackle this issue of immigration. Ladies and gentlemen, we do have a dire need to have a comprehensive immigration plan. But instead of us rolling up our sleeves and saying there are some issues, when immigrants come to this country, why are they not engaged in a process to become a citizen? And there are checks and balances and some absolute detail regulations of immigration. But instead, unfortunately, we had rhetoric, we had attacking religions, places of origin, and just throwing out divisive policies. Debbie and I stood in an airport on a turnstile fighting against that Muslim ban that was so un-American, that was so, for us in this state, having one of the largest Middle Eastern populations in the world, we know the value and the richness of those who come here who are Muslims, who are Middle Eastern, who contribute every day to our economy, to our communities. And so no way in the world was I going to stand silent in that issue. I will tell anyone, I will tell anyone, if you come to this country and you're breaking the law, you do not have the right to stay in the United States. But ladies and gentlemen, how can we turn? I had so many people come and talk to me when this happened. Do you know 80% of the physicians in Michigan are Muslim faith? 80%. So if you're going to attack a person because they are a Muslim, they may be the one that will provide healing and save your life. I had the Michigan farmers come to me and say, who do you think plants your food in America? Who do you think harvests your crops in America? If we are now seeing a decrease in the number of workers who are coming here from Mexico because of the rhetoric and they're afraid. I represent Mexican town, Southeast Michigan, and Pontiac, where there's this large, rich Hispanic population. They are running scared. And I asked some of them, why haven't you applied for citizenship? There's some people, ladies and gentlemen, who you're walking around every day in the business community who are not American citizens. It shocked me. But we don't have this comprehensive immigration plan. And this is another time. I will speak truth to power. You will not, in these United States of America, with our Constitution, rights, and laws, create policies that will discriminate and that will treat people differently because of their race, their color, their religion, national origin. Not in my America.
I too spoke out against the Muslim language the executive orders that the president has pushed through. I know too, we need immigration reform.
Yes.
My district in Southwest Michigan, I have individual farmers operations that lose millions of dollars of produce, fruit and vegetables, that doesn't get picked because they don't have the workers. I met with them and we had a big Michigan Farm Bureau contingent come out as they annually do to DC in March and April. Scared to death about not having the right amount of workers to plant things. You know, a peach tree has to be picked 3 times in August. And they don't pick them at 3 p.m. because it's too hot. So they start at 5:30, 6 a.m. so they can finish up at 3. They don't have the workers. We need immigration reform. I actually am one that is pretty encouraged that we're going to see bipartisan immigration reform before we get too much longer into this session. And I think it's going to make a lot of sense in terms of what will happen. And if people want to become citizens, there's a process. They go to the end of the line. They can do that. But for the folks that are here already, mm-hmm. they'll get legal status. You don't want, you know, I met with almost 20 folks who were here improperly, illegally, a couple weeks ago. Some of them have been here for decades.
Mm-hmm.
And they're scared to death. They can't get a driver's license. Michigan needs to, I think, provide driver's license because they can get picked up. They can't go back to Guatemala or someplace else to renew it. They're stuck. And now, if they're pulled over for no driver's license, guess what? They're on the deport list. And it's happening. So we need to look at those laws. We need to have, I think, we're not going to send 11 million people back. I mean, give me a break. That's just not going to happen. So let's figure out what the legal status ought to be, make sure that they're paying their taxes, make sure they're not in some gang or have some felony record that's more than a traffic violation. And if they want to become a citizen, there's a process. And let it move forward. And let's move forward, because our employers need these folks for lots of different jobs.
And as we're winding down our time here, we've got time for like a 30-second answer from each of you. We've talked about a host of issues here and past, present, future. If there was one point you'd want to reinforce with this audience, a message to them you'd want them to know about Michigan, what you're doing, what would it be? Or a cause or issue that you feel strongest about? You've got 30 seconds. Is there something?
Manufacturing. We need to keep jobs in this country. We need to play in a level playing field, and we need to ensure we've got a stable political climate and a strong economic environment in which to do business.
My issue is education. Ladies and gentlemen, if you do not educate a child, you are already crippling our economy and the future of this country, our safety. We cannot sit around, because if we have the resources and the money and say my child's being educated and not have the passion to ensure that every child in Michigan is educated, the skilled trades, making sure that we have the ability to turn around this imprisonment mentality we have and focus that money that is $40,000 to imprison, $8,000 to educate. Come on, let's get on board, educate and turn Michigan around. We have everything we need. We just need that educated workforce.
So a lot of good things happen when people have good jobs. And so that's what we need to focus on. And we've talked about tax policy. We've talked about workforce development. Another thing we haven't mentioned yet is regulatory reform. And we've already done some good work, actually, in the 115th Congress, peeling back some of the regulations. Next week in the House floor, we're going to be voting on the Choice Act, which is kind of our replacement for Dodd-Frank, which is a onerous group of regulations that's impeding credit and people's opportunity to grow their businesses. And so if we get that right and we get Washington out of the way, I think we can see our economy grow, which means good jobs for people in Michigan.
My big issue this last year was passing 21st century cures, which was a major bipartisan effort that we got through in both the House and the Senate, expedite the approval of drugs and devices, coupled with tens of billions of dollars over a 10-year span for the NIH, so we can find these cures for the diseases. Alzheimer's is gonna cost us $1 trillion, Medicare, in the year 2050. To me, anything that we spend less than that is a savings, let alone the impact on the family. So we're going to continue that research in a bipartisan way, and our time has expired, so I yield back.
And lower.
We have a clock up here, so it says zero, and it's counting backwards.
There we go, it's counting backwards. Fred, you get the last word. Thank you for that. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much. I appreciate
that.
Thank you. Thank you very much.